Ladies and gentlemen, and birth survivors, welcome to the Ballads of Mr. O podcast. And today we are with Paul Hill. Paul, I've always kind of thought of you as the 007 of chefs.
I kill everyone. Yeah. I cook for.
Yeah, I just see you as this suave looking fucker. Like, I just imagine you cooking in a suit and like killing the bad guys whilst you're frying your steaks. All right, but how true that is. Paul, you're like recently qualified as a nutritionist, to my understanding. So you now know more about what you're cooking,
yes.
I guess.
Yeah. I mean, I've always wanted to be a chef. So, you know, like I was very lucky to kind of have an influence in my early days. My uncle and my cousins, they're all from Holland, and they owned, like, my uncle owned a restaurant out there. So every time we used to go out there for family trips and stuff, you know, we used to obviously go to the restaurant to eat, and then I'd go into the kitchen and you'd see all these flames and shouting and excitement and pans flying everywhere and stuff. And it was just like, yeah, that's a bit of me that I need. Yeah. So I went straight into it, really. And then that kind of just, you know, and it's a case of everything, mate. You know, it's like once you start really thinking about it and manifesting it, you know, it's kind of a chosen path, if you like. So I've done the Savoy there. So I went to catering college, and then I've done a couple of years there. And I went to work in London at the Savoy to kind of learn the trade. College really doesn't teach you anything about the industry at all, because it's just more about drug taking, girls, and trying to pass your course sort of thing, really. But so I'm quite lucky. But, you know, that's how it goes. And then I went to the Savoy, kind of a bit of a baptism of fire, if you like, because just nothing can really prepare you for the barrage of, it's like going into hell. Everything's on fire, you know, but you're enjoying it, you know, and it's great fun. I've built friendships that last a lifetime, and it's only going through those experiences that you can really gain trust. Well, it's the sense of trust, you know. I didn't really have the best of upbringing, so my friends were always classed more as a family to me than my actual family. Fortunately, that's changed now. Like, I've sorted my life out, but yeah. So obviously, I went from the Savoy, kind of started thinking more with my lower region than I did my head, and moved from the Savoy up north with a girl, which I'm glad I did, because I went into a Michelin star restaurants from there, worked my way up, and we got 2-star Michelin, and things didn't go well personally for me in terms of relationships and stuff, but I was fortunate enough to work with my now wife's brother, who kind of set us up on a blind date, if you like, and, you know, and that was it, really. So I spent 4 years up there, and in that time I had my first of my beautiful daughters. But really the industry doesn't kind of, it's not really that great for families, you know, because it's so kind of, it's 100 miles an hour, 16 hours a day. You know, and when I wanted to sleep, Mika and my daughter wanted to play. So it was just like, I had to get up, you know, I was just murdered. My mental health, was it all right? I don't know back then, you know, because you don't really think of it. You know, it wasn't really an issue back then, you know. So we just kept on moving forward, really. And like how the nutrition came about was just purely because from that restaurant, I was lucky enough to be put in touch with a job that required working for a private family, a really large family, that required a chef for breakfast, lunch, dinner, functions, dinner parties and stuff. And it turned out that my boss is really health conscious, as you could imagine, you know, with all these wonderful clothes that she has to kind of maintain a certain body weight. Otherwise it could get really expensive. Do you know what I mean? And then from there, it was just, because everything in a kitchen is like just about flavor presentation, you know, so getting the most out of something may well require a lot of fat and a lot of cream and a lot of stuff, sugars and stuff that can just pour out these flavors, but they're not necessarily a healthier kind of way of going about it. So my version of scrambled eggs just requires three eggs and a hell of a lot of butter, and it's the best scrambled egg you have in your life, but you can feel your heart slowing down as you eat. So it was just a natural progression, really. My boss started talking about oxalates and all these anti-nutrients that are in foods, and it just started really kind of really spiking my interest. And yeah, no, and then from there, it was just I started finding online courses, because, you know, going for a degree or a master's at my age, which was about 39, 40, was a hell of a lot of money to start with. And could I dedicate that much time? And it was just, well, no, not really, because I need to work and provide for my family and stuff. So kind of just found some online courses, and there was more of a progression, really. I found a really shit one to start off with, and then I kind of built on that, and I built on that one, and it nicely led on to the final one, which I'd done, which was under Martin McDonald and MNU, which is the Mac Nutrition University, and just purely from his credentials in the industry, it's compared to a master's from what you learn. And I'm happy with that. You know, the information I've got from that, I can provide a hell of a lot of information and ways to lose weight or gain weight and get to your body weight goals. So it's just been a nice progression, really. And now it's kind of just kind of funneling into building my business, if you like. So I don't know exactly where I'm going with it, because everything is really early stages. But there's a lot of excitement from me, because there's so much potential in so many different areas, but it's kind of, you know, really kind of focusing on what area is my niche, if you like. It's really interesting.
Nice, yeah. Man. You're like, you're blooming. You just don't know what flower you're going to be yet, I guess.
That's it, mate.
But yeah.
Yeah.
We met, it must be like 10 years ago, near on 10 years ago,
yeah,
like through Krav Maga. And then I think like we split ways seven, probably haven't seen you in person for like 8 years, maybe.
That's it, yeah.
Something like that.
Do you reckon it was my jamming? Was it my jamming when you come round to play the guitar with me? And I was absolutely...
That's the sole reason I left the UK. It has nothing to do with the state of the country. It was all you and your fucking guitar, man. but I don't know when I met you. Like, if you were to look at your kind of like life from, you say, you know, like your upbringing, like it wasn't great, and then obviously like now you're in a place where like you have a beautiful family, like you're heading in the direction you want to, and like, I mean, I know you've put work in. Yeah. Like, from the fact that, you know, like, I mean, pretty much most people who were like in that room with us and, you know, gone to do Brazilian jiu-jitsu, spending time in the gym, like anyone who's doing that, like there's usually a reason like that they're there.
Yeah. Yeah.
So how long would you say like you've actively been like, fuck, like this is enough. Like I need to, like, you know, like when did, you know, how long have you been like taking charge and being like, I can't be that anymore, you know?
Well, I've read a lot of books, like kind of leading up to where I am now, and it all comes back down to one thing, right? And for me personally, and that's about leveling up, right? So so what do I mean by that? It's like Einstein's theory of insanity, or constantly doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. Okay, so you know, I went through a lot of drinking, you know, that was a period in my life that I'm not particularly happy about. You know, I really kind of gorged, you know, alcoholism runs in my family. And I was on a very slippery slope a few years ago. And it was just, even though I wasn't doing the things and like an alcoholic would do, like waking up and drinking to blackout, etc., etc. It still kind of had a control over me, and it kind of came to a head a few years ago when me and my wife had a almighty row, and she kind of slapped some sense into me, like quite literally. And it was just like, you know, enough's enough now. You know, I've always known it's a demon, and it had a right. It really had a control over me, if you like. But it was like once I made that commitment to stop that, because it. You know, health for me, I always felt it started with exercise. Because of being a chef and I didn't know about nutrition, it was never really a foregone conclusion that nutrition was actually what you should really be focusing on, you know?
Yeah.
I was focusing on exercise. I was thinking I was doing all the right things, but my diet and everything was shocking. I wasn't losing weight. You know, I wasn't anywhere where I needed to be. I was just making things worse. So once I realized that it's about kind of focusing on being the person that you really want to be, you know. So I had in my mind's eye this person who doesn't drink, doesn't take drugs, doesn't smoke, you know, no pharmaceuticals, you know, lives a healthy lifestyle, really happy with my family, you know. I love my wife, my two daughters, and giving everything to them. But that was a process. It was a case of, you know, I kind of had to quit the shit in my life to level up. And then once I leveled up, I emotionally, I felt stronger. And it's a really strange way of putting it, but yeah, leveling up. So I had to quit drinking to then move on to the next stage, which was focusing on nutrition. And then once I got that, and then I realized that I can jack myself to the roof, mate. You know, it's like, So then once I had an understanding of that, then it was a case of, right, so what other areas in my life am I continuing to do that doesn't serve me? And, you know, one of them was smoking weed. So I've really taken a step back from that. You know, that kind of got, I kind of substituted smoking marijuana for drinking, if you like. Because I never associated marijuana as my demon, if you like. The big one was the booze, but still, it does take a hold of you, because obviously, you know, there's a reward system when you take something like that on, even though they say it's not addictive. But you know, I beg to differ with that.
I think, yeah, anything where you're, this is the big thing for me, man. Like now, like I've stopped drinking for like, I think I've hit over the 100 days now.
Yeah.
And like, I'm still smoking a few cigarettes. I still drink coffee, but like, other than that, everything is as it should be.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, I mean, I've had so many people, you know, you get the push and the pulls when you stop of like, you know, if you just want to have a drink, you know, it's okay. And I'm just like, nah, fuck that. I think for me, like the idea of just replacing it with something else that I know that like, I know how much I used to drink. And I know if I start smoking weed, I'm going to smoke as much weed as I used to drink alcohol. And I'm going to be, I don't know, like maybe I'm in the righteous phase at the moment, but you know, you just like, I show me someone that like, I mean, obviously there's going to be athletes who prove us wrong, but for like the majority of people, show me someone who smokes like a spliff a day, who's like operating at the best they could. Like it's bullshit. Like there's no one doing that, you know?
No, you'll wake up groggy, you know, Even though you don't get necessarily a hangover, you know, you still feel like a bit groggy. I completely agree with you. My smoking weed habits matched my drinking habits 100%. Everything was about just getting smashed, really. There was no on or off. You know, it's no in between. It was and it's tough, mate. It's a tough one because. Yeah, I was always led to believe that, you know, it's when you come home from work, this is where you can just kick back, relax. It doesn't have, you don't have to have advice, you know?
Yeah, like, but I think, I don't know, like, I think there's so much hiding from, like, what life feels like. And it doesn't even mean the bad shit. I mean, I think a lot of us are uncomfortable feeling good about shit, like, and like the last 100 days have been interesting. Yeah, like really fucking emotional. Like I can just sit there and like sometimes, you know, you really, I mean, for me, like I really realize that I'm on my own. And it won't be a case of like loneliness. It will be a case of like, what does that mean? And like the brain just goes into, you know, you think about, you know, like you're the last generation of your like family who's like left alive. Like there's no one here. Like there's no one who can be like called upon. And yeah, like I just, at that point previously, you know, you fucking open a bottle of whiskey and yeah, stick some music on and do some writing and it's quite nice. And you can justify it and defend it. But like, for me at the moment, it's like, until you stop and sit with whatever it is, like completely just you, yeah, there's no, you're not processing life. You're kind of, I mean, running away from it's maybe a bit too strong, but you're not getting the full thing. So you're never going to find out what you've got to do next.
Yeah.
You know, because you can have a shitty life and you can go and drink with your mates every night or take drugs. And you just have like, you have that small enough holiday from yeah, your shitty life to allow you to carry on living the shitty life.
Yeah.
But, you know, add that up for 5 years and you're fucked.
Yeah, absolutely fucked. Yeah. Well, also, it come back down to the fact that, you know, I'm coming to your neck of the woods in a couple of months and it's like, you know, and do I want to struggle when I get to Vietnam knowing that, you know, I can't smoke weed or I can't do this and I can't, you know, I want clarity, you know, and that's fundamentally for me, you know, I've only just stopped smoking the weed, shall I say. Right. Mm-hmm. So we'll see emotionally how I get on over the next few weeks. But I think I've smoked myself into a state of actually knowing what I want from life, because as soon as I'd light up that first spliff, it was just like all of my senses had gone, sort of thing. I couldn't read, I couldn't learn, because it just wasn't.
Yeah.
So it was just, it felt like I was just missing a trick, if you like. And it's just like I want clarity now. I want, you know, I've got a focus of where I want to go, and I can't, and I don't think weed is not going to be a compliment. It's not going to accompany me on that journey very well.
Yeah, of course.
So it's a case of like, you know, I need to now get to a stage where I don't do it for long enough, where if I did want to have a smoke just to chill out, then I can maybe dabble in it, but I'm not going to light that touch paper too soon, let me tell you.
Yeah, of course, man.
You know,
I think clarity is the word though, but it's, I mean, like me and you have like obviously been on like, it's a long journey. Like you don't wake up one day and you just like, Christ, I'm a mess. And then like the next day you wake up and you're sorted. Like it's a long journey. And there's a lot of like back and like bouncing between like either the good and the bad. But I don't know, like how, I guess it's not anyone's place to convince anyone what they're doing. But like if you meet people and they're in like real pain, and you can see the habits that they form, and obviously like people will justify and they'll protect what they're doing, because it's, I mean, essentially it is keeping them alive.
Yeah.
You know, it is keeping them going, but at the same, the double edge of the sword is it's also stopping you from realizing how much pain you're in, because if you knew how much pain you're in, you'd know how much you need to fucking start doing something.
Exactly.
You know? So, but like, I don't know. It's, for me sometimes I'm like that clarity isn't like it's not always, it's when it's good, like when you're just like everything is crystal clear and you're in a good place, it's amazing. But like when the demons just like when they appear, like the clarity is like you can see them pretty close up, you know. Like they don't look good. Like, no, they do not look good.
They're arseholes. You know? Yeah.
So I mean, obviously, like we both used exercise, but how much would you say kind of like really working hard and like, 'cause for most people who are like in a bad place, like I guess, you know, some people are a long way away from being able to like just be having a bad day and just like go and do like a 10-mile run to clear the air, like which will work, like you'll feel fucking amazing, but it's you know, if you're thoroughly depressed and you're like on the back end of like a fucking ketamine binge, you're not going to get up and run 10 miles. Like, it's the last thing. But what you put in your body, obviously, is like, I mean, that's anyone can fucking do that. Like, that's the inexcusable. Like, obviously, it's difficult for you to say because you were already like well established, like in regards to your fitness, like you were already, but like how much did nutrition kind of like affect your state of mind once you really like dialed into it?
So once you start, when you can start to understand the process that, you know, if we shift our intakes nutritionally to either end of the extremes, you know, so if we go full keto, like no carbs or high carb, or, you know, the balance is in the middle, you know.
Yeah.
You know, things start going wrong when we're at these other ends, you know. So what the understanding is, you know, trying to get the bro science off the internet it's never going to happen. But you know, hopefully people will want to start to try and understand like good information, good evidence-based human studies information that can provide them with the right information to start fueling their bodies. We need a combination of protein, carbs, fats, you know, but that's just one portion of nutritional health. You know, we're talking social, we're talking physical, psychological, you know, there's different facets that all come together. And once I started establishing that, it was massive in terms. It was more confidence based than anything, because I'd always struggled with my weight. I was never happy. I was never happy realistically until probably 5 years, 4 years, 5 years ago. Where, you know, I still was doing stuff wrong until I got onto this last course that I'd done. But I was always a very jealous person, like, especially with a wife and stuff, because just purely because I thought, you know, I wasn't good enough, I suppose. And but once I realized that, you know, it was all in my control, and that I could, you know, and once I started to build a good relationship with food, which is the most important thing out of anything, you know, it's like, if you're not ready mentally to start a diet or a phase of changing your lifestyle, you're always going to fall off, and you're always going to go back to these old habits, you know, and fundamentally it all comes back down to habits, you know. And it's like, and it's a case of these bad habits that we build up in our life over time that increase our weight and increase our health, our negative health markers and stuff. These are just habits that we need to start undoing and kind of just putting in place with better habits, you know. You know, our bodies are an amazing thing, you know. The stuff I've learned is incredible, and it's just mind-boggling how, you know, we're trying to get to Mars, yet we haven't been to the bottom of the ocean as much,
or we
don't understand our bodies, you know.
Yeah.
And there's things and mechanisms that are going on in our bodies that it's just mind-blowing, and how it actually works. It's like I read the other day about erections and the physiology behind it, about a man getting an erection, is so complicated, it's fucking unbelievable. Yeah, but we just take it for granted. But the fact, you know, the fact that it takes a lot of blood from our brain and goes, you know, that's the reason why we can only think once at a time. But yeah, it's things like that. And I just, this is the message I'm going to start getting across, you know. You know, we do really need to start looking after our bodies, and, you know, and convenience isn't the way to go. You know, I was always kind of taught to believe, you know, be comfortable with the uncomfortable, you know, do things that normal people aren't doing, because normal people they're going along, they're following the herd, and the herd isn't going in the right direction. It really isn't. So how do we change that, though? You know,
I think it's tricky. I mean, like, where I'm at the moment is like it's an island off the coast of like the south of Vietnam, which it's got a party vibe. yeah, like I don't meet many people, and the people that I meet, like, drinking is a massive part of culture. Drugs, like, a lot bigger than I thought they'd be over here. There's like a ketamine's quite popular, which is weird because obviously from the UK you're like, that's the fucking why. What the fuck are you doing there, man? But so, like, I meet people, like, you know, obviously, like, naming no one, but it's really weird because, like, I mean, I'm where I am now. I'm, like, I'm just, like, locked in because I'm, like, if I go back, I may as well just put a gun to my head and pull the trigger. Like, I know what's back there. Like, yeah. This is shit at times, but it's not that. So, like, let's just keep going. So there's no real pull back there, but I just keep meeting people. Like, I see this guy and he's a teacher over here and, like, finishes work at the bar, drinking the beer, smoking the spliffs until the eyes are glazed, go home, sleep, wake up, teach, rinse, repeat. That's it. Have your fucking life.
Yeah.
Someone else, like, I'm really close to, like, you know, like, active ketamine user, smoking, like, fucking in excess of, like, 100 cigarettes a week. And fucking young, like, fucking young. And it's like... part of me obviously realizes that you have to appreciate that everybody's living their own life. And it's, you know, it's not for me to, like, put myself on a fucking box and start screaming at everyone. But it's also, like, it's really sad to see, because especially when you've been there, like, especially, you know, when you've been to where that leads to.
Yeah.
You know, but.
You know, people don't want it. Some people don't want help, though, Jay.
Yeah, it's like, yeah.
Yeah, you know, it kind of got rinsed out of me really early during in my nutritional kind of career, if you like, that that people don't want help. You know, I never wanted to be one of these nutritional wankers who go out and try and, you know, just come up to you in the pub and, like, in the urinal and going, oh, you're not looking that great. I'll tell you what you need to do. You know, because people don't want to fucking hear it. You know, it's like they have to reach their rock bottom before they do something. And it's just unfortunate, mate. It really is. Because, you know, I've charged up a couple of people just by saying, you know, I can help you. And they're like, no, you're right, mate. You know, it's like, well, yeah, and I just thought to myself, I'm just not going to waste my breath anymore, you know, because I'm quite an empathetic person, you know. I see other people's pain and I want to help them. You know, it's always been the way I've been. And it's like, but yeah, people don't want help sometimes unless they really, really need it. So
it's
like a waiting game for me, mate, you know? A good example is, and I'm sure he won't mind me saying it, but because I'm sure he'll know who he is if he watches it, is that he's just been a really, really close buddy of mine. Has just been diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, you know? We went through the kitchens together and stuff, and, you know, I saw him a few months ago and we spoke about it, you know, because he does like a drink and he has put weight on, and it's like, I'll try to talk to him. He had a couple of weeks of just going, maybe delving into not drinking as much and stuff, but yeah, it just, as soon as he kind of fell off the wagon, he was back on it, and he's just literally got type 2 diabetes. So now we've just had a conversation, so it'd be a case of, yeah, we're gonna have to do a plan, and he's gonna have to fucking pay for it this time. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
That's the problem, mate. Isn't it?
But it's like, why? Like, I mean, I did it. I'm guilty of it, I guess, to a degree. You were too. Like, I mean, why are we waiting? Because everybody can rationalize with themselves and say, like, I know that this isn't good for me. Like, I know that if I, like, you know, you say the whole thing, like, if you do all this for, like, the next 5 years, where do you see yourself? And, like, everybody can turn around and go, probably not a very good place. But this, so everyone's, I don't understand, like, why we wait, you know. I mean, smoking, for example, I mean, I'm an idiot. Like, I know that, like, nothing good comes to me from smoking a cigarette. Like, nothing at all. But it almost feels like, you know, I'd need a doctor. Like, I can cut down. I'm in the process at the moment of cutting down with the hope of quitting. But I also know, like, if I went to the doctors and they were like, you're one cigarette away from giving yourself lung cancer, which anyone could be at any given point if they smoke, yeah, I'd stop and I wouldn't miss it. But it's like, we have to, like, I don't know. It's so weird that we push ourselves to a crisis point. Like, you know, it makes no sense. You know, someone told me the other day, they were like, I only use, like, don't worry about me if I'm using drugs. I use drugs responsibly. I was like, do you think fucking every single, like, heroin overdose in the world used heroin and we're just like, I'm actually going to OD this time? Yeah. You know, like, you don't know what's going to happen. They do the fucking NOS balloons on this island, man. Every single bar has, like, the NOS balloons.
It's crazy.
And you fucking see them and, you know, they're just like, it's just NOS. And I'm like, yeah, but, like, it's that one that fucking stops your heart, you know, that you weren't expecting. Like, you might have done it 300 times and you've had a great time, but, like, you literally don't know which. And I don't understand, like, I mean, because I did it. I fucking did it. I've taken drugs that I don't know what they were. I've been in situations that I didn't think I was going to mentally, like, recover from. Like, I thought I'd lost my fucking mind. So I've done it. And it's hard to talk to people because I can hear myself and I'm like, you're preaching again. You're fucking preaching again. But it's like, I'm one in the same as these people. Yeah. You know, I've been in that place, you know. I put some crazy shit in my body, like, and I've sat in rooms and there's been fucking voices saying, like, some horrible, horrible shit to me, you know. And I'm not talking, like, empty threats. I'm talking, like, tearing, like, my character apart. Yeah. And this isn't, like, in my head. Like, I can hear these voices. They're, like, coming from the fucking walls, and I can go outside and come back in and they're waiting for me and, like, yeah, stretch this out for hours. And I mean, that's when I stopped using Class A drugs, like, that time. But I was just like,
that would definitely be the start for me.
Yeah, yeah. It's just like, why are we, why do we want to fucking gamble with that shit? Because if you think about it, like, once you hit your teenage years, you become sexually active, which involves being relatively physically well. But then, like, we immediately add alcohol because it, like, apparently, like, boosts confidence and performance. But obviously, you now know that that's bullshit. You know, if you want to be great in bed, get fucking healthy, you know, like, exactly, if you, yeah.
Yeah.
But then socializing, you know, can you socialize? I remember, like, my fucking visa agent recently was just like, you know, we should catch up sometime. Cause, like, people are aware that, like, I don't really have anyone here. And I think she was just making an effort. And she literally was just like, yeah, what the fuck are you meant to do? Like, if you don't drink. And I'm like, that is how human beings are, like,
yeah,
increasingly being built, you know. What do you do on an evening if you don't drink? I'm like, fuck, I'm like, I'm glad I play the guitar and I've got some books to read because there's nothing to do, man.
No.
But yeah, it's weird. I mean, like, you're helping my sister, like, at the moment and stuff.
Yeah.
But it's the same with, like, it's the same with her. Like, she's another example. It's like, I've been chatting to her and I can be a prick because I'm a brother, and, you know, and, like, years and years and years of like doing all these things, and I've just been like, fuck. You know, but it wasn't until she hit that crisis point that, yeah, I was like, right, I'm fucking putting you on to Paul and you need to, and she wanted to do it then.
No, good. Yeah.
You know, and that was the thing. But yeah.
Serious improvements, man. You know.
Yeah, she seems good, man.
Typically, yeah.
One thing I'm gonna get her on here actually, and we're gonna get fucking teary about the old fam.
Yeah,
but yeah, one thing that I noticed with her as well is, like, since she's been kind of following your advice, she might not be aware of it, but when she goes, like, when the shit hits the fan, like, she can calculate a lot better.
Yeah.
You know, she can talk through it instead of just being like, I need to fucking call it a day, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I'm having a chat with her tonight, actually, because I haven't had a catch up with her for a couple of weeks. So it'd be good to just have a chat with her. No, but she's doing well. She's doing well. The kids are doing well as well. I'm sure she told you. So
it's
positive, man. And that's what it's all about, isn't it? Just helping and spreading the love. That's the thing.
This is it. This is it.
Yeah.
So, if you were, right, okay, so we're going to assume that, like, every single person is somehow wired that they need to fucking hit crisis before they seek intervention, which I guess kind of makes sense, you know, and yeah, then you'd say that, you know, whatever you're doing to your life to fuck it up is probably a response to trauma that you're not going to understand how it's affecting you until you've had the crisis. So there's not a lot you can do until you've, like, had your first shot at really fucking things up, because your brain doesn't realize it has anything to do. I mean, I used to sit and drink at a bar, like, every single day, and I was low, and my friends would be like, you should just fucking go for a run. And I was like, what the fuck is a run gonna do? Like, you know, I'm like, I'm reading books trying to find the answers, and I'm thinking about everything. Like, that's where it's gonna be. That's like the philosophy. Why the fuck would I not want to run? And they were right, you know. It's not until like you start moving your body and like eating well that your brain's not doing anything. You know, you can tell yourself that you're the most creatively gifted human being in the world, but like you're going to get a lot better when you get healthy.
Well, that's it. Yeah, you know? And the thing is, you know, if we're providing our bodies with the right information, then, you know, and that stimulates the right information to be put out. So basically, if we're eating good foods that energize us and give us all the vitamins and nutrients we need, then, you know, there are hormonal productions that obviously that start in the brain and as a pulsating effect, like they secrete hormones. And, you know, whether you're in a state of stress or a state of peace, you know, it depends on which hormones are getting secreted more. And this is what I've been reading, you know, and like stress is fundamentally the worst thing you could have for your body.
Yeah.
You know, so and that all comes back down to like to feeding it right and giving it the right information. And what I mean about information is just not all about what you're eating, it's about what you're reading, what about you're watching, what you're listening to. You know, it's like it all comes back down to that whole multifaceted approach to nutrition and health. You know, it can't just be one aspect, it has to be a lot of them together, you know, which is great.
So a friend of mine once described life as you kind of start off and you're like this dot in the middle of a circle, but the circle isn't drawn yet. And like as you like branch out into other things, productive things, you add dots to essentially form this. And the whole point of life is to like be able to join the dots and draw the perfect circle. Obviously, the more points you have,
yeah,
the circle it is. So yeah, but I don't know. It's really weird. It's because I think you only need to do one thing, and then the trajectory automatically like carries you on. Like, I mean, I was 26. I was drinking heavily. I was riddled with anxiety, big like conflict based anxiety. I tried to kill myself. Accident and emergency, got stitched up. They decided I wasn't going to do it again. They let me out. And it felt like I didn't have an option. Like it was literally JJB sports, running shoes, fucking go, you know? Yeah. So, like the trajectory is kind of them. I mean, I don't really know anybody who's like had the moment and then they've decided to take the steps and then they've immediately like rebounded.
Yeah.
I think as you go down the journey, you have moments where I think the first thing is like you get that false confidence. You're like, I'm fucking on this now. Like I can afford to piss around a bit.
Yeah.
And then you piss around for a bit and then you realize you're pissing around a lot. And then you realize like it's bad because all of a sudden like you're like a monster in comparison to where you were when all you did is drink. Now you're like a fucking strong, healthy fucking monster with the same shit inside them, and it's like, yeah, now this is bad. Like, you know, this could be a lot worse.
Yeah.
I don't know. I my brain just keeps like coming back to the same thing, and it's this frustration. And it's, I guess that's it. Like, you know, people are only going to find and look for what they need as and when they need it, you know, and
yeah.
You can go a long time before it becomes like a need. Like, yeah, I mean, how many times when you were drinking did you say to yourself, like, this probably isn't the fucking way to go, but within, you know, 24 hours, you were shit-faced again.
Absolutely. All the time, mate. All the time. And yeah. I can't tell you. I mean, that moment of clarity obviously come for me when me and the wife had a massive row, but that still, you know, that still took a few months to get to the point where actually I really need to sort my stuff out, you know. But again, if you're not looking for the answers, then you're never going to find them, are you? You know, and if you don't think that there is a way out, then you're always going to be stuck doing the same thing over and over again. And I remember meeting you, mate. I do, seriously. And you were this skinny kind of, yeah, socially, you're always very easy to talk to, and I always found you a very intellectual to talk to, and a joy to talk to. You weren't just some of these, you know, you get some absolute numpties come across your path in life, then, you know, and you're just like, yeah. But yeah, that's obviously why, you know, we've always remained friends, you know, and it's like, and to see you kind of where you are now, and even though you are so far away, but it's a joy to see, mate. And yeah. Because you have come over so much, you've overcome so much, and even though you're still going through issues, like, and we all do. I know you're mentally in a place where I think you're fucking like a superhero in terms of strength mentally, mate. Seriously, you know, and just the way you approach every situation, you know, you do it directly and you smash it, you know, and I just think, you know, people should take note, and just, you know, if you are going through a shit time in your life and you realize you need to change it, you have to fucking stand up and be accountable, mate, and just say, right, enough is enough. And, you know, but I mean, the society we're breeding at the moment, are we breeding people strong enough to do that? I don't think so.
One thing I've noticed, I mean, ever since I was drinking, it's like the support that there's so much more support for fucking yourself up than there is for sorting yourself out. Like,
it's mad. Yeah,
it's like, you know, if you want to, like, say you have like a fucking devastating breakup, you know, and you walk into a circle of your friends, you're gonna find more people who are gonna be like passing you the fucking drugs and buying your drinks than there's gonna be people who are just like, we're going for a fucking long walk and a talk. Yeah. You know, they're like one in a hundred, man.
That's it. And neither of them will tell you that they didn't like your missus anyway. And
yeah.
You know what I mean? Do you know what I mean? It's like, oh, thanks. Just been lying to me for fucking 10 years. Yeah. No, it's crazy. You know, they will support you, and they'll support you in their habits as well. And
support to keep you in the kind of person that's going to basically end up in that situation that's currently destroying you. Like, no fucking time. We'll get you back there so quick. Don't worry about it.
But it's like, I started reading a lot with this Jeff Thompson. I know we spoke about it. And
he introduced me to Jeff.
Yeah. So we started, he spoke of this analogy of crabs. And I know it's been documented that, but you know, when the crabs are in the pot in the sea and they're all there and none of them can get out, but you see this one kind of making it to the top, ready to escape, they're all fucking pulling him back. And it's like, thanks a fucking lot. And that's what a lot of people have to deal with. And it's just sad, mate, because there's a hell of a lot of people, like you said, who would rather keep you at their level than watch you succeed. And like I've got fucking probably two or three friends, mate, and those three friends have always wanted me to succeed, and yeah, I don't know where else to put it, mate. It's mad.
Yeah, I think, I don't know. It's strange. Like, I mean, it's amazing how well it's disguised as like love, though. because you're the fucking, especially if you've ever been in a situation where like you're the bad guy, of which, you know, hands up, there's been many situations, you know, I fucked up a lot.
Yeah.
But especially when you watch these situations from the outside and you're like, you watch what the supposed like heroes of the situation are doing, like the good guys, you know, that we've got your back are doing. And it's, yeah, like it is, it looks, you can even see and go, yeah, that looks a lot like love and fucking tenderness and care and what this person needs. And
yeah,
oh, I don't know, man. I don't know.
No, it's you know, I think as long as you're kind, as long as your heart's in the right place, you don't try and corrupt people and stuff like this. Just try and live your life, man, and be,
push on.
You know, and just focus on those, focus on just different areas that make you happy. You know, like I said, get good food. Start, you know, and if you don't know, ask someone, you know, there's plenty of really decent people out there, you know, and it's, it's just taking that step though, isn't it? Just taking that first step, you know, because I personally think I need to go and see a counsellor just through what I went through. So I've got in contact. I got in contact with a friend who gave me a number of their counsellor. So I'm gonna start speaking to someone, man. It's been far too long. It's probably something.
Yeah, I highly recommend it. But saying that, something you could have done, but I think like getting into something like a talking therapy, like when you're where you are now, allows you to make so much more use of it.
Yeah.
I mean, like when I did therapy for like a year when I was in the UK, and just being able I was pretty sober back then. I think I'd made a point of like not drinking too much, but you know, the rehashing the shit that hurts. I mean, my sister's literally, she's going through it herself. Like, it's horrible and it feels crap. And it's the same thing with anything you go through in life, that shit. Like, it's only going to feel good if you're avoiding it, you know? So you face it and it's bad. But when you learn to consciously recognize exactly how the stuff that happened to you has affected you, like precisely, like to know exactly what's going on, like emotionally and physiologically, like, you know, because I guess, you know, we have the kind of like, we have triggers in life that are directly linked to whatever that was, you know, and as people who are like giving up substances and stuff, that those triggers will usually really what send them back. So yeah, I think as a like, from like where you are now to kind of, it's probably the best time, you know, to go and work it through. Like, I mean, I'd love it. I mean, I'd love to have a fucking like regular therapy.
Yeah.
This
could be it though for you, man. You know, this podcast, man. Mm-hmm. I think it's brilliant. It's brilliant for you, man. And well,
yeah,
I'm really enjoying it.
Good, man. Yeah, I've got a young woman who I used to work with when I was doing my behavioral stuff with the guys with autism. We're going to have a chat, but like, I'm very well aware that every time we talk, I usually end up in tears. Like, she's just, she's a psychotherapist, but it's going to be a tear for a while. Okay, like closing up, I'm not going to give you a number. I'm not going to say give me 10 or give me 5. Like, free to speak. But like, you've got a human being in front of you. They're willing to listen, but they don't want to be fucking, you know, they don't want to be told you need to go to the fucking gym 7 days a week and like treat life like that's going to scare the shit out of them. Like, yeah. using kind of like nutrition, and not entirely nutrition, but your journey, like you touched on before, like just be kind and don't try and corrupt people, which is fucking amazing advice. And it's amazing how many people you see in the world who are like not doing that. You know, it's really bad. But like, if you had someone in front of you who was like, you could tell they were on the verge of breaking, maybe not on the verge of like asking for help, you know, what gentle nudges would you give them? You know, like, if you needed to just take the fucking edge off life without hiding from it,
yeah,
like where would you go?
I mean, first and foremost, man, I'd always go sleep first. We are designed to have a period in our day where we need to just stop and restore and rejuvenate, and that comes through sleep, you know. And if we're not getting that in the right amounts, you know, so we're getting REM sleep, we're getting deep sleep, you know, we're coming in and out, we've got right cycles, we're getting like 7 or 8 hours sleep, you know, they that really depicts your day, if you like, you know. Because you've seen it, you know, you've had a really shit night's sleep, or you maybe not have gone to bed or something like that, and your choices throughout the next day are fucking outrageously shit. From food to movement to what you're watching, and you could just literally go walk straight back into a bar and start again. But the thing is, you know, it does for me. I'll always promote sleep first, you know, and try and get your sleep right. Look at sleep hygiene, and then that rolls into nutrition, and then exercise, socializing, just make sure that you're reading the right things. And you know, it's a very difficult answer, you know, it really is, but First of all, I think you need to just take someone needs to just take a grasp of their situation. And if it's not heading in the right direction, they need to visualize this person that they want to be. They need to get their goals on paper. Because once it's on paper, it's out there in the universe. You know, even get it on the wall. And I know people say it's all airy fairy shit, but this shit's worked for me. You know, I've as soon as things have gone down on paper, it sets the intention, and I'm there. I'm going for it. That's it, really, mate. I just think.
Be honest and
ask for help. You know, be honest and ask for help first.
Yeah.
You know, recognize.
Yeah, my fridge is a collection of fucking notes from my wisest self to my not so wise self on regular basis. The sleep thing though, like my sleep is fucked at the moment, like really, really fucked. And it's like, so I don't know, like I still don't. So I had the bike injury, like when I stopped, it was the day I stopped drinking, you know, which like, you know, there's a TBI there, like I know it was there, and I knew that I got some mood changes, which kind of worked to my advantage because I was just short-tempered, which if you're going to the gym every day, it's fucking great, you get shit done. And around the same time, like I met someone, and since then I can't pin on like what it is, like either this falling in love shit, which I'm fairly sure I'm doing at the moment, is fucking horrible. why I've spent so much of my life living like the kind of drunken, like I wouldn't say womanizer, but you know, like short-lived relationships, you know, and pushing people away. Like when you meet someone who really starts to feel like something, and really fucking quickly as well, like it's scary. Like you're like, I'm fucking, you know, I'm like, I'm nearly 40, I'm pretty rational, and I work shit out, and then all of a sudden you're like, I'm like a 16-year-old mess, you know, at points. But yeah, so my sleep's fucked, and I don't know if it's like, it could be a result of the head injury, it could be the fact that like I just don't like not being with the person who I really, yeah, it's like that kind of thing, isn't it? Like you do something and it fucking feels great, and then all of a sudden it's not there anymore, you know, for a period of time. But like, I think telling people, including myself, I mean, I know, like my fridge says sleep more on it, you know, I know I need to sleep more, but like I have days when I don't, like I just can't do it, like I'm tired, I feel like shit, and the more time you spend awake doing nothing, like that's not good for your head, because it's too much thinking time, and it's tired thinking, it's not clear thinking, it's like that's when you trip yourself up. Like they say that, Leo, like mental health is linked to like the more you kind of follow the presence and absence of natural sunlight, like the longer you're awake under artificial light at nighttime, like the more chance you have of developing like mental health issues.
Absolutely, mate. This is where I think it does stem from as well. Look, reading a lot on sleep, because you know, naturally, if we're all living in tribes outside, you know, once that sunlight's gone, that's bedtime, isn't it, really? Yeah, I mean, I know there'd be a campfire and stuff, but you wouldn't probably traditionally stay awake around the fire for too long, you know. And yeah, and then you wake up with the natural sunlight, so it's definitely worth a go, Jay, I think, you know. Just maybe start thinking about going to bed when it starts to get dark, and then as soon as it starts to get light, wake up and just try and change your rhythm around, mate.
Yeah, man. I mean, 5 a.m. feels good. 5 a.m. feels like a good time. Like it's not too early to be like, this is ridiculous, but it's not. I get like the impression with a lot of things, whether it's like what we do with ourselves, especially like electrical devices, what we eat and stuff, like the more we can kind of push our habits to that, like pre-Stone Age, pre-industry, like the hunter-gatherer, you know, the more that you can incorporate that into your life seems to be, is like best, like the better genetic match to like,
yeah,
our like potential reaching selves, you know.
Yeah, I think so, mate. I really do. So, you know, obviously we can't there'd be very extreme cases, obviously, with emails, and everyone's connected to everyone, so anyone can reach anyone at any given time. So you have to be really strict, I suppose, with how you do it, because you don't want people, you know, you're just about to nod off and then you get your boss emailing you or something, and it's, you know, it's just ruin it. So yeah, I think there does have to be certain rules you need to place in you to get to where you want to get to, for sure. But it's
I think like the phone switch off is I think that's my next move. I think the cigarettes and the phone, because I hate them. Like I've always disliked mobile devices, but then like it's weird. Like if you become connected to a human being who you don't live with, they're like your
lifeline.
That's how you talk to them, right? Yeah. And you know, it's, yeah, like just setting those rules and, you know, just being like, you know, as of fucking 8 p.m., like, I'm just not going to be available. Like, if you want to do anything, I'll leave a fucking key outside for you and come. But, like, I can't.
No, exactly. You know, because it's about protection at the end of the day, really, isn't it? Because if you're trying to get to a place that you want to get to, but you're getting all these outside influences, like, knocking you off kilt and kind of trying to draw you back to where you was, you know, you have to protect yourself, man. And the good thing about it is you just turn the fucking thing off and just go, I lost my phone or something. You know, that's the thing. And that's the beauty of the do not disturb things on the phones these days, and focusing and doing deep work and not getting distracted. You know, there's definitely something in that, for sure.
The ability to just make a decision and ride with it.
Yeah,
you know, to say that, because I mean, obviously you can do not disturb your phone, but like if you're interested to see if something's happened, then you know it's fucking right there. You just have to turn it back on. But I guess that maybe it's a discussion for another time. The human beings and that kind of like the hardest thing is to make the decision. You know, even like you can go, this is good, this is bad, choose the good, but then you're like 5 minutes into doing the good and you'd be like, yeah, but I could probably take something from the bad as well. So you're already like rerouting yourself.
Exactly, mate. You know? Exactly.
Awesome.
All right, mate, really that, Joe.
It's been fucking nice talking to you, man. Nice talking to you.
Yeah. We'll do it again for sure.
Yeah, awesome. There's no fucking posh ending bit, so I'll just stop it at some point.
We've got a theme tune. You got to get a theme tune, mate.
I watch you march out amidst the many. I'm the stranger in your shoes. You've got no way to go on going. You've often said this makes little sense to you.